Good afternoon, everyone. We're going to be talking about free motion quilting today, and I've got lots of great ideas to share with you. And we're going to make sure, here we go. My phone's up. All right, so we're ready. I'm going to start, and what we're going to talk about is free motion quilting. And really, there's so many different types of free motion quilting. And sometimes it's just confusing to think about how many feet we have that we can use. Some feet come with the machine that you can use, and some are optional feet that you can buy. But we're really going to talk about how you can make a decision about what is the best foot to use for your project and the threads and all of that kind of thing. Now, I'm the kind of quilter who tends to use a lot of different threads, a lot of different feet, and I like to play. A lot of the projects I have to share with you today are smaller ones, but I have some behind me that are larger ones. And if we get time, I'll go to them. And for me, when I first started free motion quilting, it was a mystery what foot I should use, what thread I should use. And that's why I'm going to start at the beginning. And this is one of the quilts that I made. It is a stained glass window. It was one of the very first quilts that I ever quilted, and I used invisible thread. And I thought I would love that because the thread wouldn't show as I was stitching in the background. And this is the quilt. Let me just get it up here like this, see if I can get it back a little bit. And I really love the quilt. I think it turned out great. But I wasn't very pleased with the idea of using the invisible thread. One of the first things I discovered, the thread that I was using, that if you ironed it and the heat was a little bit too hot, it would melt the thread. So right here, there was stitching in this block. But by the time I finished, I pressed it and then realized the thread had disappeared. And so I became unenamored of invisible thread after that, even though there's a lot better invisible thread that's on the market right now. Back when I did this quilt, there really wasn't, and it tended to be very sensitive to heat. Today, you can get a lot of different threads that are invisible, and you can get darker smoke ones for darker fabric. But I don't necessarily love using them because I like the idea that I'm using a real thread, regardless if it's a rayon, a polyester, a cotton. Now, if you're working on a quilt for a baby or a child or something you know is going to be washed all the time, you're probably going to be using a cotton quilting thread or a polyester thread even. Now, years ago, nobody would ever want to use a polyester thread. I think that was something that came from the times that you should always use natural fibers, natural threads with natural fibers, and they were afraid that the polyester thread was so strong it would cut through the fabric. But today, I think the way that we quilt our threads, we tend to overquilt them. There's so much thread in there, and the fabric is so stable, I don't think you usually have to worry about that too much. Now, when you're coming into art quilts, that's a whole different ballgame, because when you're quilting an art quilt, there is no rules. You can use metallic threads, you can use rayon threads and embroidery threads, anything you want to. And really, it becomes more about the balance of the thread that you're using in the top and the bottom. So in this case, when I did this stained glass window, I just chose a fabric on the back that was the lighter one because I used a print because I didn't really want to see the stitches. It was a fabric that I didn't particularly love. And after I was finished with it, and I really loved the front of it, I had to ask myself, was it really worth it to put a fabric on the back that I didn't like? When it really does for me, every time I look at it, I think, I saved a couple of dollars by not buying something that I really loved. So since then, I tend to really think through not only what I'm putting on the front, but also what I'm putting in the back, because that is as much a part of the quilt as anything else. Now, this was the standard idea of how you could learn to do free motion quilting. And it was just a simple design that I traced onto the fabric, and I just used a simple fabric in the center. I think it was like 25, 24 inches, something like that. I traced it and then I added the triangles onto it and did some designs and free motion on the back of it. And I'm not sure if you can really see in the light too much, but on the front, when I was doing this, there was a light pattern, a tone-on-tone pattern. So I just followed that tone-on-tone pattern that was printed on that. And that's a nice way of figuring out if you're having trouble trying to decide how you want to do your free motion quilting. That's a nice way to be able to take away the stress of it. You just follow the pattern that's on the fabric. And after I finished outlining the pattern on the main part, then I did free motion tightly around the rest of it. So another simple way of practicing and kind of getting used to playing around. Now, this is the first one that I did on my creative icon. These were applique designs that were built into the creative icon. And they're also on the Creative Sensation Pro 2 and Pro. So if you have these designs, you'll kind of see, I've just kind of brought them in and placed them where I wanted to. And then the quilting that I did afterwards was very, very simple. It was just going up and down in close lines, kind of echoing what was happening around, not echoing the flowers so much as just the background, really nice and tight and close there. And that was, it's hard to see right now, but there is actually an overlay that I put under this. I had a green fabric kind of that looked like the back, and I wanted to get a little bit of that ombre look to the front of it. So I found this dress fabric, and it was like one of those prom dress type of things. And it has a lot of stretchy knit to it. It's not a knit actually, but it's got these pleats in it. But I love the way the color went from light to dark. So that's what I used on top of the cotton to kind of make it look like it was getting darker as it went down. A real simple idea. And for those of you that do have these designs, they are so fun to play with because you can just bring them in and place them where you want to. But it's a great way to kind of practice your free motion quilting. Now, there's also art quilts where you're doing thread painting. Now, thread painting is a whole different ballgame because you're putting a lot of very dense stitches close together. And usually if I'm going to do thread painting, I've got a couple of small examples here. This is all done. All of the stitching you see here is all thread painting. So you don't see that on the back. On the back, I just got a little bit of stitching. What I did was I had my batting and then my front fabric. I did all the messy stitching through just the batting. And then after I was finished, I added the back and then did a little bit of just outline stitching to make it all be connected. And that is a really important thing to think about if you're going to do anything that's having thread painting. Now, we're going to go and look at the feet that come with your machines and the feet that you can buy as an option to decide how you would decide what you're going to use. So I'm going to flip over here to the machine. And right now, I'm on the Quilt Expression 720. And I am going to touch the screen so that I can make sure that I'm going to go into free motion. So the free motion symbol is very, very similar on all of our machines. And it looks like a little curlicue up here. I don't know how clearly you can see that. But that little curlicue, when I touch it, will let me select from the different feet that we have available to us to use with our machine. So when we're talking about our different feet, I'm just going to put this down a little bit so you can see a little bit better here. There is a Sensormatic foot that comes with many of our feet. And this is what's considered a floating foot. If your machine came with this, it is something that you can use and set up and to do free motion quilting, and then on your machine, you would choose the Sensormatic free motion option. There's no springs to it. You don't have to take the ankle off. You just leave it the way it is, and then you're done. I'll put that up there like that. There's also the dynamic spring foot, which is the foot that comes with our embroidery machines. It's called the Dynamic Spring Foot 60 free motion. And so this is what we use in embroidery, but it also functions as a spring foot. And if I was using this one, then I would select that on my machine. The other options that we have available to us are a true spring action, where it's a foot that comes straight down and you can see the spring, how big that is. And that is got an open toe to it. So that means your visibility is very, very clear. You can see what's happening. I tend to use this one for free motion when I'm doing thread painting because I can got a much better view of what I'm doing. And I also can do zigzags. I can use decorative stitches with it. Now, the last foot that I have, that's one that's on my machine right now. And this is a spring foot. You can see it has got a plastic on the bottom. It's got quite a big of an open area. And what is lovely about this one is you don't have to take the ankle off. When you're using the spring foot like that looks like this, you have to take the ankle off. And some people prefer to not have to do that. So this would be another option. I'm working on the Quilt Expression 720. So what that means is when I choose one of the free motion options, and I'm going to get the light a little bit better here. When I choose one of the free motion options, the feet teeth drop automatically. And I have, you'll notice the feet teeth are down because I've already selected the free motion. But if I was to turn it off, the feet teeth don't come up right away. Then when I take the first stitch, they'll come back up. But since I'm working with the spring action, I'm going to choose that foot and the feet teeth will stay down. For those of you that have older machines, you need to make a couple of different choices. If you have an older machine or if you have a machine like the Ambitions, the feet teeth don't drop automatically. There's a lever for you to put the feet teeth down. If you don't put the feet teeth down, then when you go to move your fabric underneath, there isn't going to be any room to move the fabric and the feet teeth are going to be pushing the fabric through and won't give you any freedom. Now, somebody asked a question, is there a better foot to use for different purposes? Absolutely. And that's why I'm starting like this in the very beginning. I personally like the options that you can purchase, right? The Sensormatic foot that might come with some of your machines or the 60 dynamic spring foot. If you're just doing a little bit of free motion, then those are fine options to use. But if you're going to be doing a lot of thread painting, then I would use either the open toe spring or the spring foot that I have on the machine now that's got the clear opening to it. If I'm working on a quilt, and I'll come back here for a minute. If I'm working on a quilt that has a lot of seams, and you know the kind of quilt I'm talking about, right? There's a lot of piecing. Every 2 inches, there's another seam, and you're going up and over. You absolutely have to use a foot that has the spring to it. And so on a quilt that's got a lot of seams, I would use the open toe spring action foot. And let me see if I can bring it up there a little closer to you. You see the one that's the open toe. And I prefer this one for a quilt that's got lots of seams. For the thread painting, it's kind of the same thing. If the Sensormatic foot is so tiny, it's closed in the front, I have very, very little visibility of what I'm using. So I would almost never use the Sensormatic foot that has come with some of your machines. It does the job, I just don't get the same kind of visibility that I need. And the same thing with the 60 dynamic spring foot. I just find that the other two options work a lot better when you're doing thread painting or free motion. So I would break it down mostly into, if you want to do thread painting, you want the most amount of visibility that you can get. And some people are going to have a preference. The reason there is a couple of different feet that do the same thing is because some people have preference. I like the open toe metal foot when I'm doing thread painting, because I tend to be doing 100,000 stitches a minute. I'm moving and I'm doing a lot of stitching very close together. And a lot of times I'm working with zigzags and other decorative stitches. And so I find that this gives me the ability to have a wide stitch and I can move really quickly. We're going to come back to the machine for a moment. And if you have other questions, please ask me as we're going. All right. The other thing that when you're starting is, as a beginner, we tend to focus so much on the fact that the stitches are supposed to be all the same length. I can guarantee you, if you look at any of my samples, that the stitches are not the same length. It's an overblown expectation. And it stops people really enjoying free motion quilting. So I have a lot of projects here that are kind of meant for you to have fun and that are smaller, but that they don't necessarily make you dislike free motion quilting. If I'm going to do something that's got feathers and every single feather has got to be exactly the same, then I'm going to need a lot of practice. And I don't necessarily want to spend 10 hours practicing. But if I'm doing smaller projects, like the landscapes, here's another little landscape project that I did. And same thing, I've got some satin stitches. You'll notice I have some ribbon embroidery. And then I free motioned in the sky. I free motioned in the water and around there. These were fun projects to do. Mostly I was working with the colors like the blues and the greens. When you look at the back, you can see some of it's quilted and some of it's not. And it's the same type of thing. When I'm doing thread painting, I'll save some of that and just do it on the batting on the front. Now, I have a much bigger project that's free motion, and I'm going to show it to you in a minute. But we have one other foot that we haven't talked about, and that is the echo quilting foot. So the echo quilting foot is really special for if you're going to have a design. This was an embroidery design that I did. And around the applique designs, I was stitching a quarter of an inch and I echo quilted around the design. You can't see it because I use the same color thread as the background. When I look on the back, you'll be able to see it a little bit better on the back. So when you're echo quilting, we do have a specific foot that's called an echo quilting foot. And it allows you, it's hiding around here somewhere, disappeared, I'll pull it up in a minute. It got tucked underneath something I was doing. And that has got a very flat bottom to it. And so it allows you to see the markings of a quarter of an inch and a half an inch. And that means you can keep your quilting consistent along the edge as you go. And I'll come back to that in a moment as we get going. I'm just kind of walking you through some of the different options as you go. Here is another quilt, a small one, where I did the same thing with the echo quilting. Around the flowers, I echo quilted in white, so that you can see the stitching is, let me go this way, come across like that so you can kind of see. You can see the parallel lines of stitching, and that's what echo quilting is. You basically go and follow the shape that you see here, and then as you go, you keep coming and lining it up a quarter of an inch apart or a half an inch apart. So somebody asked the question, do you use a straight stitch throw plate when you're doing thread painting? I never, ever, ever use a straight stitch plate when I'm thread painting, because so much of the time I might want to switch from a zigzag or a satin stitch or maybe to a feather design, something like that. Now, if you choose a feather stitch, it's not going to look like a feather stitch. It will have a look, right? Because it'll go up and down and side to side, but it won't look like the traditional stitch because the feet teeth aren't moving that stitch. All that's happening is I know the needle's going to move left and right and left and right. And so I can get into a rhythm following that stitch. I'm going to show you a couple of other things that I've done some thread painting with, and it'll give you a little bit of an idea, and I hope get you a little bit excited about doing it. And then we're going to do some free motion on the machine. Okay, so let me just stop for a second. I was going to look at it back here, but this is a project that I did that has a lot of thread painting in it. The sky, if I held it up to the light, I don't know if you can see, but that's thread. There's no fabric there. So to do something like this, I would have Aqua Magic or the Dissolve Away Max, which is a heavier plastic stabilizer. And then all that is thread. There's no light around here for it to show through. But if I was holding it up to the light, you would be able to see the light through that thread. And then the rest of it was done with free motion. Now, the tree was a little bit more complicated. The tree is very, very heavy. You can see here, I have branches that are three-dimensional. They're just kind of sitting there. And if I wanted to do something very, very dense like that, and I wanted to do a lot of messy stitching, I wouldn't do it on my quilt. So I'll show you the order. Here is an example. This was a tree, exactly the kind of pattern that I chose for the tree. And on here, I could attach it with some 505. This is a 505, a pretty standard spray adhesive. You just spray on the back of it, and then it will, if you wait and let it dry, then it's tacky and it'll stick to your stabilizer. Then you don't need a lot of pins. You can also use things like Roxanne's Basic Glue. Those aren't things that we sell, but you can get them at any quilt store. They're pretty standard and you can find them very easily. So I would put something like this, and it could be a butterfly. It could be anything that you want to do that you want to have it freestanding, right? Maybe you just wanted to make thread and do a really delicate angel wings. Well, you could do that, but you do it on the Aquamagic and you make as many messy, messy stitches as you'd like. And then once you've got it the way you like it, then all I did was I picked it up and I laid it on top of my quilt. And when I did this, the back was already quilted and everything was 99% done. The only thing I did not have done was the binding. And so then I picked the tree up and I'll bring it up over here just to kind of show you how it goes. All right. And I laid the tree down. I decided where I wanted it to be. And see how cool that is. And then I just top stitched it in free motion right along the edges where I wanted it to sit. So there's not, you don't look on the back of this and see a lot of messy quilting. This is just almost the last thing that was done on this quilt, was just deciding where I wanted the tree branches to be. If I didn't like a couple of them, I could cut them off. And then you really can kind of get the idea of how this was done. And that was such an easy way to add a lot of heavy quilting to a project, but not distort the back of the quilt. Look at the back of the quilt. You just barely see where that tree is. There's just a little bit of quilting. And that's a nice way to do thread painting without having it affect your machine. Now, when I did this, much of this had a satin stitch on it. And some of them, I even put a cord inside. You can see it on this one here. See if I can pull it up nice and close to you. There's a cord, like a piping cord, that I actually stitched a satin stitch over to give it that nice solid edge, because I wanted that nice solid edge to be inside around where the sky was, so it would have some support if I didn't decide to stitch it all down. So the nice thing about thread painting is you really can use everything, but you would not use a straight stitch needle plate. You would use your zigzag plate for anything like that. Okay. Anybody else have any questions that I haven't answered so far? We're going to go and head to the machine for a moment, and we're going to just talk about some simple, simple ways of setting your machine up. I have on here today, I have a red thread in the bobbin and an orange thread on top. And when I'm quilting, I'm usually going to take into account what I have on the back. In this case, I have a print on the front. On the back, I have this was like tone on tone. And here I've got a print that's kind of more fancier and it's got multiple colors on it. Whatever stitching I add on here, whatever color thread I decide I want to use, it's going to disappear on a backing like this. So if you're just beginning, try and take it easier on yourself. Do not use a solid color on the back. Think about how you can incorporate a print that really makes it, ties it into the front of your quilt, but it doesn't make it so that everybody looks at every single stitch, because really the only one that is really going to bother is yourself. So I like to make it easier on yourself when you're doing free motion quilting. So I'm going to change the camera over. All right. I'm going to come back and get a little bit closer here. Now I have my thread through the needle. I have selected my foot, which is the Sensormatic foot, and I can double check that if I'm not sure what's going on here. So I have the spring motion free motion foot on. And what I want to do is bring my bobbin thread up to the surface. You notice I've done a little bit of stippling here, right? And stippling is actually one of the hardest things to do when you're doing free motion if you've never done it before. what happens is we tend to kind of work in lines. Notice how I did a line here and then a line back and a line there. And it's hard to break out of that routine and go somewhere else. And so that's why it's kind of a nice, it's fun to practice it, but it's not enjoyable to do on a piece that's very, very important to you. Now, quilters that are very, very experienced quilters, they always will bring their bobbin thread up above the surface and bring it up to the top. There's a couple of different ways you can do that. You can touch needle up down on your machine. And when you do that, it'll put the needle down. And now when you put the needle back up, it brings it up. And if you're holding your thread, it will pull up the bobbin thread. See the way it pulled up the bobbin thread there? Let me get this a little closer to you so you can see it. So there's my bobbin thread up above the surface. The bobbin thread is the red thread. And that's one way of doing it. The other way of doing it is to turn the hand wheel down toward you, one full repeat. And then as you're holding the top thread, it will pull up the bobbin thread in the same way. I usually like when I'm starting to put my thread underneath my foot and start it in the same place where it came up or just beside where the thread came up. I'm working with the Quilt Expression 720. So I have an automatic lift that's going to, when I start putting my foot on the pedal, my foot is going to come down all on its own. You will also have the knee lift for people who like that. You certainly can do that. But I find with the automatic lift that you really don't need the knee lift. And it's nice not to have it in my way. So I'm going to just move my foot pedal here a little bit so I can stitch it. When I start, I'm just going to keep my hands on those threads just for the first couple of stitches. And usually what I'll do is I'm going to stitch away from it. I'll take a couple of stitches where it started, move away, and then I'll come back over that stitch so that I know that that stitch is locked in. And then I'm going to trim these threads because having threads hanging around on the top can cause you a lot of problems, all right? So I'm just going to start. I'm going to move, do a couple of stitches, and then move away from it. And now I'm going to stop. Now, I want to stop with the needle in the down position because it's going to hold my fabric, and I'm not going to have a big jump stitch. Somebody asked a question. If it doesn't mess you up too much, can you lower the angle of the camera? Let me just see to the foot more. Let me see if I can do that. I think I can. I know what I can do. Let's see if this works better. There, I think that's going to be better for you. How's that? All right. So one of the things that a lot of people tend to do is when they're starting, they just start sewing and they'll free motion quilt for an hour until they stop and they suddenly look at the back and they realize that their tension's not very good. When I'm working with stitching on a quilt that I really care about, I won't always match my weight of the thread on the top and the bottom. That is going to depend upon what project I'm doing. I often, when I'm making a decorative quilt that's going to be a wall hanging, will work with rayon. And I'll work with rayon on the top and rayon in the bottom. Sometimes I might want to work with a heavier thread. All right, we've got lots of threads here. This is a sulky blendable thread. It's cotton, it's variegated, and it's a 30 weight. So I might use this on the top, which is a heavier thread, but I might decide to use a 50 weight thread on the bottom, like an Orifil or something else like that. It's a personal choice, but this is exactly why I wanted to talk to you about this. It really does have an impact on what your stitch is going to look on the front and the back, no matter what threads you're using, even if you are using the same threads, what you should do when you start off is test to see if you've got good tension. Like, don't spend an hour doing it. Spend a minute. And the best test to see if you've got good tension is to do small little stippling, all right? So I'm just going to go. I'm just doing small little curves because that is really going to highlight if you have a problem with your tension, it will show you right away. If you're doing small curves, that's when you're going to see it. And when I say a problem with your tension, I don't mean there's anything wrong with your machine. I mean that anytime you are free motion quilting, whether you're on a long arm, whether you're on a mechanical machine or an electronic machine or embroidery machine, you always should be evaluating before you start if everything is set the way that it should be. All of our, or most of our machines, 99% of our machines have automatic tension, which is fabulous. But automatic tension does not mean you never should touch it or that your machine can read your mind what you want to do. What I love about automatic tension is it is allowing me to make changes. And then the moment I want to go back and go back to my regular sewing, all those changes have been canceled. So it's not making any permanent changes. So anybody that's afraid of playing and adjusting your tension, it really is not warranted, because automatic tension means it will automatically go back the way it was when you go to a straight stitch or anything else. So I hope that makes sense. And I'll come back and talk more about tension if that is an issue. Now, for those of you that do have the automatic cut, you know, the thread snips that will come down and cut your top thread and your bottom thread, it may come as a surprise to you, but that does not work very well when you're doing free motion quilting. So if you've ever had an experience where you're free motion quilting and you use the thread snips and it didn't cut the bottom thread, there is actually a logical reason for that. And that's because of both the free motion feet that we're using, whether it is the spring action or this one that's on here right now, because it is a free motion foot, there is no pressure on the foot to hold the thread down, and the feet teeth aren't there. And so sometimes it might work and sometimes it won't, but you shouldn't expect that it's going to work all the time. I'm going to do it right now to show you, and there's only a 50-50 chance that it did it. All right, look at that. It did it. But the next time it might not. And I want you to realize that that's part of the fact that this foot doesn't have any pressure on the stitch plate and the thread when it's making that cut. So what I'm going to do is look on the back. All right, I'll pull this back a little bit. And what I'm checking is to see that any of these little curves, that I don't have any spider webs hanging out there. A spider web is when you get a stitch that's very, very loose on the back and you've got all these legs hanging out of it. I'm going to go and change my tension. Maybe I'll change my tension. Let me think. Should I do that? Why not? I'm going to do this in reverse so that you can see what a bad stitch looks like. Over here, I have my tension set at 4.6. I'm going to bring it down very low. Let's bring it down to a 3.0. All right. And I'm going to do my stitching from the top. You're barely ever going to see anything from the top, but on the other side, you're going to be able to see how good a job it did. All right, so I'm doing the same thing, a nice tight little curve. All right, and I'm going to lift my foot up and lift my needle up, and let's look and see. Well, it didn't do a bad job, actually. I have to go a lot lower than that for it to give me a bad look. That's pretty good. So you can see there is a lot of room for adjustment here. Maybe I might have to go down to a 2.5 for it to look bad. Let's go down there and see what that looks like, all right? I'm going to bring it down to 1.8. Let's see if I can get it to do a bad job. And every machine is different. All right, let's see. Did we get our goal here? It's just starting to not very look. You can see the threads that are hanging around here. It's still not bad, though. It's not giving me the look of a spider web. I think I'm going to have to draw that on my board. It's not as pretty looking as this, right? That looks really nice. You can see that the thread is sitting more on the surface, but it's not giving me the look of the spider web that I would talk about. So let me just change my camera here, and I'm going to think about coming over right here. Hold on. Okay. So I'm going to put this up. All right. So when I'm talking about spider webs, if your tension is not good, and it's all about the balance of your thread, right? The bobbin thread and the top thread. So if on the back, when you're looking at your stitching and you do a tight curve, and then you see there's all these spider legs like this, then you know you've got a problem. And the problem is easily solved. It's not a problem with the machine. And let me see if I'm going to need to pull this up closer to you so you can kind of see that. I might need my lines. These are my spider legs here. All right. This is the bottom of my fabric. So if on the bottom of your fabric, you see that the straight stitch is kind of loose, and then you've got all of these other threads hanging out, then the answer is to increase your upper thread tension. All right. It's almost always increasing your upper thread tension. So somebody said, what is the name of this foot? This is a spring foot. And when you look at the machine, I'm going to go looking at the settings here. Spring foot free motion. Oops, wait a second here. Okay, spring foot free motion. I didn't choose the dynamic spring foot. I chose the spring foot free motion. And that's what you would choose for the foot that I've got on. And this is a nice foot. It holds my fabric really nicely, and it's open toe. And then the other one that you would use, the spring foot, would be this one right here that's got that open toe to it. That's got a big spring to it too. This one you'd have to take the ankle off. All right. And then let me put my fabric back in here. Well, I can't believe how well that did, considering how much I changed the tension. It really didn't make a difference. Now, when I want to go and set that back to the way it was, all right, I'm going to go here. Right now, my tension's at 1.8. I can go and bring it back up. When it goes up, see how it's like a lime green? When it gets to where it was originally, it'll go back to being that white color. So there it's set back where it was. I'm going to show you a couple of other projects and things that I've done. And then we're going to talk a little bit about the ruler foot. This is a ruler foot. We have our own ruler foot that we've had out for the last little while. But first, I want to talk to you a little bit more about some creative things you can do with free motion. So the, let me just pull this up. This is a free motion leaf bowl that I made. I think this is the kind of stuff that really makes fun playing if you want to do free motion quilting. When you're looking at it, I guarantee you there's not one stitch that's exactly the same length. It really doesn't matter when you're doing something like this. And these leaves were very fun and easy to do. I'll show you a couple of different ways you can do it. Obviously, you can buy some leaf fabric. The leaf fabric, you know, there's plenty of that around in the fall. But we also have the ability to, where did that go to? Oh, maybe it's underneath here. I lost it. What I did was I printed a leaf onto fabric. And if you think about, you know, how we can Google things, I Googled maple leaves, and actually I live in Vermont, so we had lots of maple leaves when I made this, but I wanted some variety. So I Googled maple leaves, and then I printed them on fabric sheets. And you can get fabric sheets at any quilt store. Very, very easy to find them. And I loved it because what it did was it released my brain from having to worry about what color I was going to make the leaf. If this was fabric, I would have chosen the same color fabric as my leaf was, and then I would just stitch it. And that's kind of what I did for this. Now, in this experiment, and it really was an experiment, some of them, one of them I used the moldable batting. And the moldable batting and the one that I did with Warm and Natural, and the one I did with Quilter's Dream Cotton, and the one I used all different kinds of battings. One of them I used fusible fleece. Because the stitching on it is so dense, when I was done, you really cannot tell the difference between any of them. So the moldable batting one is just as nice and firm as the other ones, and you can kind of shape it as you go. But a fun way of kind of playing around with free motion quilting. Here's another example. This was the same type of thing, except with this one, I didn't put batting in it. what I did was I fused two pieces of fabric together, and then I did the free motion for the veins. And then just stitched them together, top stitched them together. This I made for my Thanksgiving table, and it was pretty fun. And then I made some place cards that matched it. And I think I'm probably going to be coming out with this project in the fall. So look for it if you're interested in how this was done. But really, the same process was done for the leaves. The only difference is here is I print them out on a regular printer, just an inkjet printer, and then I've just played around with these kinds of projects. And this is another project that was done. You can see this is three-dimensional. Really fun way to play around with free motion quilting. This one, I used a craft foam that you can get in the stores, in the craft stores. Not the good craft foam either, the cheap stuff. You know, the stuff you can buy, craft foam that's it's just, you know, they use it for kids crafts and stuff like that. And I had two pieces of fabric, one on top and one on the bottom, and I free motion quilted it. And then when I was done, the craft foam reacts to heat. So you can either use a heat gun and heat it up, and then it will get this shape. What I did was I put it on a can of tuna in the oven at 375 for about 10 minutes. And then all of these edges started to curl up like this. So, you know, we're used to thinking about doing free motion quilting for large quilts, you know, quilts that are bed quilts and stuff like that. But there's not a lot of satisfaction as your first few projects of doing a huge project like that. It kind of takes the fun out of it. So I really suggest think of some smaller projects you can do, whether it's wall hangings or, you know, fun things like this that you can free motion quilt. And a lot of the times when you're starting, and this is a project I made a million years ago. I know it doesn't look like me. This was a quilt that I made that was a self-portrait. And it really did look like me at the time. My hair was a little bit lighter, and I had a little bit more hair for that matter. But, you know, look what I used on the front. I used a fabric that was very easy to free motion in the background, and I just free motioned around the flowers. And then on the back, I chose a fabric that the stitches would disappear. And that's such a nice way of being able to have fun and enjoy yourself and not agonize about everything being perfect. So the questions about the feet, we have two options as far as being able to learn more about how you do free motion quilting. So there is a footbook. So those of you who have the footbook on page 20 and 21, there's a list of all of the free motion feet. Every single one of them is there, and it tells you what they recommend to do. They tells you how to set your machine up and all of that. On our newer machines, you don't really need to make any changes as far as tension. You need to drop your feed teeth if your feed teeth don't drop manually. And if you have an option on your machine, some of the older machines, for the presser foot pressure, you can lighten the presser foot pressure, and that gives you more room to be able to move your fabric around like this, okay? So that's an option. There's also the catalog, the accessory catalog that you can find online, or you might have one. You can get it from your dealer if you want to hand one. And that one lists all of those feet also. I'm going to come back and just pull up a couple of different things. And then we're going to get back into doing some more free motion. And I'm going to do some thread painting so you can kind of see the difference in the process. Here was another picture of an iris that I took. And I haven't started quilting it yet, but I'm going to do free motion, and I'm going to come up around the petals of the flowers and start playing and doing free motion for doing something like that too. So when we're thinking about what feet we're using, if you like to do ruler work, we do have this ruler foot. All right. It comes with its own screw. I have the screw in there, this big wide screw that you're seeing. You'll notice that screw is quite a bit bigger than the screw that you normally have on your machines. That screw comes with the ruler foot. And you'll see how deep the ruler foot is here. It's very, very tall, and that allows you to be able to put the ruler against it and not have the ruler go underneath the foot. Now, there are many, many rulers out there. There are 1/8-inch rulers, and this one is a 1/4-inch ruler. For our home machines, you should be using the 1/8-inch one, one that's going to fit underneath your foot as you start sewing, okay? The one that is a 1/4-inch one, that is for your long arm machines, and those are not appropriate for your home machine if you're doing free motion quilting. So, does anybody have any questions while I'm getting myself set up? I'm just going to move over. Make sure I've got what I need. That's very interesting. And we'll talk about some different types of quilting as we get going. So if I was thread painting and I wanted to make a tree, for example, or a flower, thread painting means you're going to be putting your stitches really close together. And I do have a straight stitch that's selected right now. And so I'm just going to do the same thing. I'll bring up my bobbin thread. See if I can get a little bit closer in there for you. I'm going to bring my bobbin thread in. This time, instead of touching needle down, I'm going to tap my foot pedal. I'm going to tap it again. And you can see how easily that brings up the bobbin thread. I'm going to lift the foot up. And then I'm tucking my thread back there like that. So thread painting means that I'm going to have a lot more stitches. Somebody asked a question. If you use a thicker batting, shouldn't you be able to adjust the height of the foot? Yes, you can adjust the height of the foot. You can adjust the press-to-foot pressure height. When you're in free motion quilting, it automatically happens on a machine like the Quilt Expression 720, but some of the other machines are more manual and you'd have to manually go in and lighten the press-to-foot pressure. So it depends what machine you're sewing on. If you're doing free motion quilting on a machine like the Quilt Expression 720, that happens automatically that it lightens the press-to-foot pressure. So I'm just gonna start a little bit and then I'll answer the next couple of questions, all right? Somebody said, I missed the part where you talked about correct free motion foot and which setting to select. I'll come back to that and I'll make sure to end up talking about the right setting for the right foot. All right. Right now, I'm just showing you how you can do free motion thread painting, and I'm going to make a flower. So I'm going to outline it first. All right. And I'm just going around and kind of getting my shape into place. Now, I'm not going to have very much stitches unless I was choosing to put a stitch, like a satin stitch. Let me see this satin stitch here. So if I wanted to really get some dense stitching, you'll notice I have satin stitches that are all here. That would be the kind of thing I could do if I wanted a satin outline. So what I would do is go and change. I leave my settings for my free motion, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to change my stitch. So I'm going to go here and I'm going to choose the satin stitch. Now that's a very, very wide satin stitch. I don't think I want to be that bold. So I'm going to go and narrow it down. Let's make it 2.7. Well, 3.0. Okay. All right. So now, when I start stitching, remember my feet teeth aren't doing the work. The fabric is only going to move if I do. So I'm going to go a little slower because my needle is going left and right, left and right. And then I can come around. If I don't change the angle of my fabric, the satin stitch will look different as I go forward and back. I guess I might as well finish it. I'll just do around here and then you can look at it. And I'm on a plastic table, so I hope it's not bouncing too much. All right. So let's look and see what that looks like. So there I did a flower, free motion. It's not perfect, but I wasn't aiming for perfect. I just wanted you to see how you could use decorative stitches when you're doing thread painting. So if we go back and look at some of the things that I thread painted, like the landscapes, there's my leaf that I was looking for. All right. And where did that one go? I put it down here. So in this case, look at the thread painting I did. I've got a zigzag that I used for the grass. If you really look at it, the way that I stitched it was like this, right? My grass was sideways, and I went and just did a zigzag back and forth, free motion. And that's how I created all the grass. I'll move it back a little bit more so you can see. The tree was a combination of satin stitches and different stitches. I've got some poppies growing here. This is a little satin stitch that I did free motion back and forth. But look at the grass. Really, all the grass is a zigzag that moved left and right and center. So it was an irregular zigzag I did. On the water, I did just a straight stitch back and forth, free motion. And I kind of just stopped sometimes and kind of came down a little bit for a little bit of a curve. And in the sky, I did a little bit more lighter. You can see I made it puffier by not stitching so close. In the leaves for the trees, they were just an oval shape, and I just stitched around with a straight stitch to add those. But it's changing the texture from a satin stitch to a zigzag that really can give you the feeling that it's almost embroidered when you're looking at it. So I hope that came in pretty clear. All right. So somebody said that the, let me just go and look at the questions, okay? Somebody said the performance icon does not adjust the press foot pressure automatically for the thicker batting, does it? I would have to turn my icon on to check on that and see, but I'm going to go here to my settings, and the press foot pressure on the Quilt Expression 720 is down at zero. So it has taken all the press foot pressure off right here. You see where there's nothing there. So there's no press foot pressure on there. If you're on a machine that does not have that ability to do it automatically, you're manually going to do it. A lot of times you'll find the press foot pressure is going to be over on this side of your machine, and you're manually going to lower it to zero. Especially the older machines, that's the way it's going to be, all right? So when I'm over here, I'm going to get out of the settings and touch OK. For those of you that don't know where the settings button is, it looks like a little gear. And it would be the same on a performance icon or a creative icon. And usually the presser foot pressure is going to be dropped completely so that this is coming down and is very light. Now, you can usually go in, I believe, on the icon and lower it to even less than what zero is. For depending upon the foot you're using, you do have that kind of option. So you might have that same option with the performance icon. So the person that asked about the performance icon and the press foot pressure, she's saying, I use a ruler foot with it, and I had to raise and lower the foot myself. Well, it depends upon the setting, and it depends upon, usually the performance icon has a setting for the ruler foot. And so that setting for that specific foot may be that you need to go and do it yourself. But a lot of it depends upon your batting. The average batting, you're not going to need to change the setting. It's usually fine. But if it's a thicker batting, then you may need to. But it's nice that you have the option to do it. That's the important thing, that you can do it if you want to. So when we're talking about decorative stitches, when I'm set my machine, I have it, free motion is set. I can go to any decorative stitch I want to. I can go to the stitches and I can choose this irregular zigzag. It goes from the right side, it stops in the middle, and then it comes over to the right. So I used that one when I was doing a lot of my grass because it kind of stopped irregularly. And then as I was using it, it gave it a little bit more of an irregular look. And I like that. But you got to play around with the stitches. The most important thing to think about, though, is the stitches need to be able to fit in the opening of this groove, right? This is the open toe spring action foot. And the one that I have on here is the spring action foot with the plastic base to it that you leave the ankle on. This one's got quite a big of an opening. It's got a bigger opening than the open toe foot does. So thread painting, this can be a really nice option. I personally love the open toe spring action. As I said, when I'm going over a lot of bulky seams, do you notice that that foot is got a, it's tipped up in the front? And that's so as you're going over seams, it's coming up and down, then this will go over the seams and it doesn't get caught up in it. Which the Sensormatic foot, it doesn't go up and down, it floats. So as you're using a Sensormatic foot, it's not going up and down. And I'll change to this so you can see what it's like. But it's great for maybe stippling really small areas. But when you're going over seams, it'll tend to hit one of the seams and it won't go over it. Whenever you're doing something with a lot of seams, you really need to be using a spring action foot. I hope that makes it a little clearer for that. I just want to make sure we're answering all of that. Marilyn has a Sensormatic open toe free motion foot, but the press foot pressure is grayed out so that the foot is not floating at all. I have the needle down and the automatic press foot lift up. Marilyn, I will check on that afterwards, and I'll come back and put a comment in afterwards to anybody that I didn't answer. I'd like to check that out myself before. I'm not sure on this machine if it would do the same thing, but I'm curious. So why don't we just go in and we're going to check in the settings. We're going to put our free motion and we're going to choose Sensormatic, and then I'm going to go touch OK. And now when I go to the settings, let's see what happens. And the presser foot pressure is still down at zero. So we'll see. I'll come back and answer that if I have a different answer for you, okay? Usually the presser foot pressure is down at zero whenever you're doing free motion quilting. The presser foot pressure is off completely. So the open toe spring action is not going to work with 9 millimeters. The opening is not that big. I probably would not do more than 6 millimeters with it. But a lot of times when you're doing free motion thread painting, you don't want, and I'm going to come back here. So think about thread painting, right? If you were doing thread painting, you wouldn't necessarily want to have a stitch that's 9 millimeters wide. If it was a satin stitch, it means it's going to be going from here to here, a very, very big stitch. So you could almost put your finger underneath it. And that's not going to work very well. So I would resist the temptation, even though you can, with the foot that I've got on, do 9 millimeters, I wouldn't do it because you're moving the fabric on your own, right? So if it's a 9 millimeter stitch, it's going to go from here. And if you move your fabric fast, it might land again way up here. And it's going to give you a stitch that's way too far apart. So unless you are a super speed person, you're not going to want a stitch that's wider than 6 millimeters when you're doing thread painting, for sure. And you can play around with that when you start going, but generally speaking, you're not going to do that. Now, I found my leaf. This is a leaf that I did on a fabric sheet that you put through your printer, an inkjet printer. And when it's on there, when it goes through the printer, it's got a paper on the back of it. So I just did this morning. I printed one out so you could kind of see it. And what I did after you take it out of the printer is you take the paper off the back of it and then you put it in some water, some regular water, and that sets the color so it's good. So you'll notice here I have a printed color on here, and on the back I put a red that I thought would look nice. So in this case, I would put red on the bottom, and then on the front, I would change my colors. I might put yellow and greens and oranges, and wherever it's got orange or red, I would put orange thread or red thread, but I would probably leave the bobbin the same color and not really change it at all. Now, in this case, you can see those are the fronts of the leaves and those are the backs of the leaves. Here, I had green that I was doing that I put in the bottom so the veins would show at the last step. And then around the edge of the leaf bowl, I did a satin stitch and did it in free motion. And that kind of covered up all the raw edges and kind of made that possible. So fun, easy things to do. You certainly can buy a lot of fabrics that will have leaves on it and different things. Maybe it's maybe you're into poppies, right? Find a fabric that's got these big poppies on it and you can do the same type of thing. Imagine how beautiful it would be to have a poppy that had all those leaves and leaf shapes on them. Let's see what time it is. Our time's almost up. How did that happen? I just can't believe that that happened. For those of you that have a couple of questions that I didn't get to, I'll go back after. I'm going to check in the manual and make sure that I know what I'm talking about. I don't want to promise something that's not there. And then I'll come back in and answer those questions afterwards. So I hope you feel like you're in the mood to be a little more creative. Somebody did ask me about the iris. Yes, the iris was printed on fabric also. This was a photo I took. And then I printed it on a fabric sheet. This is a larger fabric sheet. So, you know, when it comes to free motion quilting, start small. You don't have to do huge projects to play around. Make some placemats and play around with some different techniques and just start using the feet. I will make sure that there's a list of the feet on the top. You can find out the part numbers if you don't have them. Make sure once you've done it and you've got your thread in the bottom and your thread on top, that you do a short stitch out and test the tension. Make sure the back looks as nice as the top. And then if you almost always, 99%, if the back thread looks very, very flat or you see any spider webs, then you're going to need to increase your upper thread tension. So normally it's set at 4.6. You might bring it up to 4.8 or 5.0 and then do that little test. Don't be afraid of taking a couple of scraps of fabric that are the same as what you're using and test it out to see whether you like it or not. And that when free motion is one of those very few things that you're going to get different results depending upon the thread balance you use and the weight of the threads. And it's just a perfect thing for you to go and do a test. I don't want anybody to think it's going to be perfect that when you start out, it may be, but if you never look at it, then imagine the opportunity you've missed to be able to make it even nicer than what it is. Somebody said, does the photos fade with time when a picture is taken? Well, this photo was taken 4 years ago and I haven't decided what I was going to quilt it with. I just got it out recently. So that's faded after 4 years. I think it's still pretty good. And when I can always, the thread colors I use are going to help to make that a little bit more intense too, because I can use more intense thread colors. So I don't usually worry about it fading too much. The leaves that I did on the leaves bowl, I did, that was a project that was a while ago. One day I'll post that project because I have the project written up. I'll post it on the Pfaff website so you can have it, okay? So I want to thank you all for joining me. For anybody that I didn't answer your questions, leave me a note on the Pfaff Facebook page and I'll come back and answer the questions individually so that I know that everybody's got the answer to their questions. And I hope you really go out and have some fun. Our machines are fabulous. This is quilting month. March is quilting month. So make sure to have some fun. Try something new that you haven't tried before. And if you've never free motion quilting, give it a try because it's really so much fun and creative. All right. Bye, everybody. It was nice talking to you.